So, short introduction, both Robert Oosterveld and Marcel Swiers are working here at the Donners Institute on a range of things. I think it's probably too much to fit into a short time. But specifically today, they'll be teaching us more about the BIT standard. We've had, over the course of the past few days, a number of discussions and some in the slides about Nifty, DICOM, BITs, which one is good, which one is bad, which one is nice for your purpose or not. And this talk will expand a bit more about that. So I think, Robert, are you going to start with an overview of BITs? And then Marcel is going to take us a bit more into some tooling to help us convert to BIT standards. Thank you very much. And I don't have to say welcome.
No. No. Thanks.
So
you can.
Okay. So we're indeed going to split the talk into two parts. The first part is going to be an overview. There's a lot of details in BITs. I'm not going to cover all those details because what we think is more important is that you get a feeling for how you can work with BITs, and that's what Marcel is going to demonstrate. So Marcel is going to give a short explanation, but then switch over to a demonstration. And we considered whether we should do the demonstration also with you guys on your laptops, but given that we're presenting in this room, that would be difficult to get all the software and all the different files on your computer, we decided not to do a demonstration. But I'm pretty sure that after you've seen what Marcel has to show, that you can also do this yourself on your own data sets. And I'm also confident you all have your own data sets that you can work with. So let me start with the first part about BITs. So I'm not an MR person. I'm an MEG researcher. I'm passionate about open science. I've been sharing my open source code for more than 15 years. That's the Fieldtrip project, which is a large MEG EEG analysis toolbox used by thousands of people. But I'm also really passionate about open data. And about 5 years ago, we started with the Donners data repository, which I've already been discussing with some of you. So for me, that's really important that we also structure our data. And that's also where my interest in MR data comes from, because that I also want that to be open. Marcel is an MR researcher. He's also here at the Donners Institute. And Marcel is responsible for facilitating people's MR analysis, especially for the larger projects. So Marcel is involved in a lot of projects that involve like hundreds to thousands of participants. And he's in general involved in a lot of the MR that happens here. So what is the brain imaging data structure? Well, it's this thing that you have already heard of a lot about the last few days. It's already like in a pitch for you working, helping us with the BITS MATLAB, etc. So I just quickly want to like ask you guys, who already knows BITS? That's quite some of you, right? Yeah. So BITS has a lot of details in it, and I know that I cannot present those details in 10 minutes. So that's also why I decided not to present it. What I'll do is I'll give an overview of some of the more like core concepts that you might not be so much aware of. But just very shortly, for those of you who don't know BITS, BITS is not a file format. It's a way of structuring your data. And it's also a way of providing metadata. So it specifies which file formats are to be used. And those are standard file formats that already exist. And that's Nifty, JSON, and TSV. It specifies a naming convention for files and for directories. And it addresses the problem of metadata getting lost while we're doing our research. So for example, the details from the DICOM headers which are lost in translating the DICOMs to NIFTYs. So that's being addressed by BITS. But it's also details about our participants, our research participants, or details about the cognitive task and experimental manipulation and stuff. So how do standards proliferate? This is one that you might know. So the situation, we have 14 standards, 14 competing standards. That's ridiculous. We need to develop one universal standard that covers everyone's use cases. And in the situation, you have 15 competing standards. So this is something that we're very much aware of. So BITS is not a standard. You should think of BITS as a way of providing you with a very widely supported and widely adopted guideline for best practices. So the BITS is a specification of a data structure. It is not a standard. We're not enforcing anything on you. But we as a BITS community, are trying to help the wider community to adopt best practices. So that's how you should think of it. So it also makes it a little bit more flexible in your cognitive mindset, in that there's no very strict BITS rules, there's no BITS police, etc.
There's a BITS validator.
There's a BITS validator, yes. I'll come to that. So BITS is about brain imaging. BITS was initiated at Stanford University and by the group of Russ Baldrak to address the challenges that they faced with openfmri.org, which is now migrated into openneuro.org. And the main focus is on brain imaging, so neuroimaging. And neuroimaging is often done in relation to cognitive experiments or cognitive neuroscience. So that means that BITS not only focuses on the imaging aspect, but it also focuses on the cognitive research questions, so also the behavior, the experimental manipulations. But it also has to do with other measures of brain activity, which means physiology. BITS started off in 2016 with a specification for MR data. That is also more or less the time that I got involved with BITS, because this paper came out and we realized that for the MEG community that I'm well known with, that we also wanted to have a better way of sharing our data. So we said, like, if we can extend BITS to also cover MEG data, then we'll be very happy. So we started work on BITS for MR, for MEG, which appeared in 2018. And then we continued in also extending BITS for EEG, for scalp EEG, and for intracranial EEG. But also at this moment, BITS is still a growing specification. So we're still, like, people working on extending BITS to other domains. And you could think of BITS as a style of research data management and a way of organizing your data. And that means that you can also use it for BITS-like datasets. That's actually how we started here at the Donders, to organize our DICOMs in a BITS-like fashion without directly converting to Nifty. And I think also you should use the flexibility to start thinking about, like, how can you use the BITS style of organizing your data for modalities which are not in the specification. And that's, for example, what we're doing here. We often record eye tracking data or video data, which we're also storing in a BITS-like fashion, although it's not part of the BITS specification. And as such, you from the open MR community, I can also imagine that you're doing MR on other body parts than the brain. So I can imagine BITS also being relevant for other body parts than the brain. It's not something that I know of, but it's something that you can consider, that this style of working might also be valuable for you. So just to give an example of a BITS data set. So this is an example with anatomical MRI, with MEG, and with EEG. And what you can see is a directory structure with fixed file names. So let me first point out the directory structure. So subjects are clearly identified. This is one subject. Of course, the list would continue. And for each subject, there are different modalities. So here you can see the modalities anatomy, so anatomical MRI, MEG, and EEG. And what you can also see is that for the EEG, there's actually one file that has EEG data in it. That's the EDF file. But what we also do is we do a lot of metadata. So we add a lot of information, both at the level of the EEG recording. So what are the channel settings? What are the filters that we use? What's the reference channel? What are the location of the electrodes, etc. But we also have data that is metadata that describes the recording at the larger scale. For example, what are the characteristics of the subject? Was it the patient? Was it a healthy control? What's his age? What's the mental state, etc. So this is how you should think of a BITS data set, that it's a combination of data and metadata in a well-structured fashion. Just a short project background. So BITS is the result of an ongoing collaboration of amazing people like you guys. Like, BITS is really a community effort. BITS was started from one group, but BITS very quickly adopted a wide range of people that are contributing. And the specification as we now have it, that's the result of sharing knowledge, having extensive discussions, and reaching consensus. Those discussions, they happen on the email discussion list, in shared Google documents, and we have a GitHub repository. Because the specifications nowadays is maintained in GitHub, and you've all seen, like, at least most of you now have seen also how to use GitHub. And for us, it's just a very, for us, like, in managing this BITS community, it's just a very convenient way to structure these discussions. So if you go to the BITS standard repository organization on GitHub, then you find the BITS specification as one of the repositories, and there's a lot of people that have contributed to it, and we also try to organize discussions there. So BITS is based on consensus. There's no higher authority in BITS, but we do have a governance structure. So we have specified, like, how are decisions being done, and how do we make sure that BITS represents the requirements or the wishes or the ideas of a wider community. And one of these things that we realized with bits is that bits will continue to grow. So what we have specified is that bits is growing through extension proposals. And the bits extension proposal is referred to as a BEP. So we have a whole list of BEPs, bits extension proposals. And each of the BEPs has one or two people that are leading the discussions of the bits extension proposal. And as of last year, we also have a steering group. And the steering group is not doing the work, is not deciding on anything. But the steering group is overseeing the whole efforts and trying to smooth things out, like trying to identify like where is more work needed and trying to motivate people to get that work done. And the steering group consists of Guillaume Arniso, who's in Madrid, Russ Poldrack, Kirsty Whittaker, who spoke here on Tuesday, Melanie Gans, who's in, a pet researcher in Copenhagen, and myself. And what we try to achieve with the steering group is that we represent not only the different modalities for which BITS is relevant, but also the different career levels. Because BITS should not only be relevant for PIs, or not only for PhD students, but actually should be relevant for all scientists. So last slide, just if you want to leverage BITS for your research, you should be aware that BITS is, on one hand, it's the specification. And the link to the specification is here. And that's just a document that you can read. And it's a relatively dry document. It has a lot of details in it. Probably not all those details are relevant for you. There's some examples in it, probably not the example that you're looking for. So that's why also the knowledge is really important. So we have a website. And we have a starter kit. So like we have the main BITS homepage. We have the starter kit, and the starter kit is a very important point where we try to get more knowledge. It's a wiki, it's very easy to contribute to, even easier than contributing to GitHub. And of course, we have the email discussion list, and we have Neurostars, which is more like an online forum where you can quickly ask your question and then someone else can chime in and provide the answer. So that's really important to know. And then, of course, we also have tools. So for me, part of this hackathon was working on BITS MATLAB as one of these tools. And we have, the BITS Validator is one of these important tools. It will help you in constructing a BITS data set to see where whether your data set complies with the specification. And as such, it's a very general, very useful tool. And it's an online tool. It runs in the browser, but it runs locally in the browser. So you don't have to upload data, but you're using the browser to validate your data, which is locally on disk. But there's also other tools, like Toolbox, that are using it. And that is like an ecosystem of tools is now like being developed. Like PyBits is one of these tools, like Python library. MATLABits is something that we've been discussing over the last few days. And of course, there's BITS apps, which are more than simply libraries. BITS like fMRI QC or fMRI Prep are these large BITS apps, which make the whole processing of large MRI data sets much more efficient. So there's a lot more that we can tell, but I think what's more interesting is to actually see how to construct a BITS data set, because that's what we have identified here in the center. Like it's the first hurdle that you run into. Like you can use existing data sets, you can go to OpenNeuro, you can download a data set. But if you're working with your own data, then the question is like, how do you get this in BITS? And that's what we're going to address. And what I propose is that if there's any questions about BITS, about the specification or on the process or that stuff, that I take them at the end. Then we now move over to Marcel. Okay?
Okay, hello everybody. Robert said before, I support a lot of the data flow and the data processing, MR processing here in the center. And obviously I also promote for these PhD students and so to use the BITS standard. And a lot of the people here in the center, they are not really computer scientists, they are more like neuropsychologists, so they're not really that comfortable with coding. And since I have to support all these people, what I did is actually, I made a tool called BITSCoin, which is a tool that I support here in the center, so to convert raw MRI data into BITS standard. And I'm gonna give a demo. I will show you how that's done. And I'd also like to say that this is really a user-driven approach. So all these users, they come up with new sequences and new kind of data organizations, and that's how sort of my tool grew. And you will see in the next slide. So like Robert showed you already, so the purpose is to go from the DICOMs to a Nifty data set that you see in the middle. And this picture has often been shown to promote bits so you can share your data. But actually, I added another column because this allows not just to exchange data or share data with other people, so you can give your data to somebody who can process it and vice versa. But this is also true for software developers. So if I develop an app, a so-called Bits app, like an application that works on my Bits data set, I can also give you my software, and other people can give their software to me. So it's also about exchanging software packages, code, not just about data sharing, but also code sharing. So this is also important for that. Now I just want to give you that message. So there should be a third column in this picture, I think. So, like I said, I developed this tool mostly for PhD students because they are faced with this problem. So their supervisor, if they're lucky, says, well, why don't you work in Bits, huh? So that's everybody is now so fashionable, so you should do that too. And then, the PI or the supervisor doesn't know how to do this, so it's that the problem of the PhD student who doesn't have the time investment to do that as well or the knowledge. So it's the problem of the PhD student that I want to sort of address. And there are many tools out there to help you. And some of them, they are rule-based, and often what you see, so this is UDConf, which is a very popular tool, I would say. This is a rule-based package, and it comes with a manual, and this is, I think, step 10 in the process to convert your raw data into bits. Well, I don't know what you think about this, but most PhD students here in the center doesn't really think this is very user-friendly. So I have to, that would involve a lot of work for me to support this. They have to know Python, they have to know all these MR physics details about phase encoding directions, et cetera, et cetera. So this is not the way forward, I thought, so at least not for us here in the center. I think it could be a lot easier. So like I said, this was step 10. So I thought of the problem not as a rule-based problem, but it's actually a bit of a mapping problem. Because if you want to devise rules how to convert your data into bits, there's always exceptions to the rules. It can be very complicated. Some rules are not unique. But if you see it as a mapping problem, I don't know if everybody's familiar with it, but you make a unique mapping between, let's say, a source and a target, then you can have a lot of flexibility. So I thought of this problem as a mapping problem. So I thought, okay, researchers that have a specific data set, and they know exactly all the data that they have, so they have all the knowledge, and they know how to do it in bits, but maybe not know all the rules, but they know exactly which point to connect to which one. So that's why I think you should approach this as a mapping problem. It makes it a lot easier. So that's what I did. And so the thing is that users here in the center, they always know their own experiment, most of the times, at least, I hope. They always know it, but so they have knowledge. And the thing is, how do you get the knowledge, which is in the head of the researcher, in an easy way, into your software that converts it? So that's really what I try to do, to make this mapping knowledge that the users have to employ that. So that's what I developed, this tool called Bitscoin. It's an open source Python toolkit that, like I said, that maps your data into the Bit standard. And the good thing is that this is a command line tool that runs also automatically without any intervention. And you don't need to know coding. So in principle, you can. So you can also script against it, but it also runs with a GUI. So you don't need to know how to program. And like I said, it's not rule-based, but it's a mapping. But you can also, as an institute here, I provide a default mapping which contains prior knowledge. So I know about certain sequences that are collected here in the center that are diffusion sequences or functional sequences. So you can also already give some prior knowledge in the toolkit. And users, they can add their individual knowledge because they know their own protocol, whether they did a resting state or a functional scan, etc. They know exactly which one is which. And they can inject that on top of the prior knowledge. So that's sort of the philosophy. And then the information is taken from the raw data, like from DICOM headers, but it could easily be extended to Philips format or GE or things like from the Nifty header, even if you have Nifty data. At the moment, this is not implemented, but the DICOM definitely is. And it also has a plugin system. And this information that the user, the prior knowledge, as well as the information that the user adds on top of it, is stored in a very simple YAML file. It's a little bit like a JSON file, so it's a key value pair. It's an easy readable text file. And people can manually edit, but I also wrote a GUI around it to make it even easier, and I'm going to show you that. Yeah, and this is what I said already, actually, that institutes like this institute, but also in your institute, you could also provide your own, what I call a bits map, which is the prior knowledge, which maps your default sequences into a bit standard. This is what I call a bits mapping. There's a file called bits map, and you can create one for your institute, and then hopefully all of your scans, or at least most of your scans, can be done automatically. This is a very, without any programming, this is just the editing a text file. Yeah, and the thing is, when you do this, a lot of unexpected things you encounter when you start interacting with users. So people do magnitude image, phase images with multicoil, and then multiband, and then multi-echo in one acquisition. So that sort of thing, so when you develop this tool, you originally think like, this is how it works. But you need to harden your tool a lot against field maps, like all these things that are listed here. So this tool that I now present, it has been hardened a lot in this center. And if you're going to use it, please, if you have found an exception, come to me. I can adapt it to also to harden it against your center. I'm happy to do that. There's, like I said, it's a GitHub, it's an open source package. So on GitHub, you can find me or this package. And then it comes with a manual there with the tutorial as well, with all the explanation. So you just Google Bitcoin, and I think it's number one list on the list. So that's good. So now what I'll explain a bit more in detail how it works. So the workflow is that this is also designed for ongoing experiments. So halfway through, you can also convert. So you run what I call a bits mapper, which basically identifies the type of scans that you have in your data set. So it makes a map of your raw data, of your source data, your DICOM data. And it comes with it's a command line tool, so it comes with a very easy interface. It's called BitMapper. And then you give it the source folder and the target folder. Your source folder is where your DICOMs are, and your target folder is your bits folder, where your bits data will be. So just these two arguments. So it will scan the source folder for different types of DICOM files, basically. It makes a fingerprint of each DICOM file, and if there's a new one, there's a new, recognized, there's a new scan. And then once you have done that, you've made your mapping, and then you made that mapping also the way you like it. So this particular DICOM file should be this particular bits entry. So you make that mapping to your how you like it, and then you can run the bits coiner, which is the workhorse, which is doing, it's fully automatic, it just converts it. It just does the actual conversion. Yeah, so, and every time you have a new subject, you can run the bits corner again. Well, this is how it works. So you just need two commands. That's all. And there's a GUI in between. And you can also run that. That GUI is called the bits editor. You can also run that separately if you want. That's in the middle. But the bits mapper will launch the bits editor at the end. But you can also run the bits editor yourself if you want. So, now, I'm going to demo this. So, you know, demoing is always a super risky business. So I'm going to do a live demo. Like Robert said, I'm not going to let you all type with me and do the thing with me. I think you can do it yourself. In this case, given the short time window that we have, it's, I think, a little bit better. So I'm going to demo it. Let's see. Now I need to go to my VNC. Yeah, you can all read this, I suppose. Okay, this was already a previous run, so I had to sort of was testing this morning. So what I did, I already installed Bitcoin, which is just a pip install. So you can create your Python environment, you do pip install Bitcoin, and then in principle you have the package. So it's not should not be too hard, just a virtual Python environment and pip install. And then you can run, so in this case I have, let me see if I can show you the input data. So in this case, I have a folder called raw, and in there, can everybody read that? Maybe I can make it a bit larger even. Let's see. Yeah, I can. So it doesn't help very much, or is it just a just a folder is getting larger. Anyhow. So there's subject 3 and subject 59. Well, in subject 3, there's session 1. Okay, this is just one session. And in the session, let's make this a little bit smaller again. So in the session, there's a number of series. So you recognize them as DICOM series, I suppose. So this is how the data is flowing in our center to our project storage. So this is what PhD students get. Yeah, so they have this MP-RAGE here. They have a localizer with IMA file. So this is the Siemens scanner. They have a lot of scans here. And for subject 59, in this case, some different scans. Normally, this is the same. And then the bits mapper will actually, when it comes to subject 59, it won't do anything because it's the same. But in this case, I made it a little bit different just to demo. So I have two subjects here. All right, so now my bits mapper is going to go through them. So let's run that one. So I'll do bits mapper. Bits mapper, it should be. Yeah, bits mapper. And I say, okay, it's in raw folder, and I want to have a bits folder. Yeah. So the raw folder is my input folder, and I just say, okay, go for it. Now we wait and for the crash. No, it's working. So you see, it's doing extensive logging with if there's any warnings. This was very quick. It is very quick. It scans DICOM headers, and for particular fields that uniquely identify your DICOM your scans. You can change them if you have any different ones in your center. And it says, okay, now it's ready. So now check the mapping, basically, it says, because the prior knowledge is in there, it already suggests the mapping, but you can now put your user knowledge in there. So this is the prior knowledge. So it comes up with this GUI. And what you see here on the left is the different unique DICOM files that it found. The bitsmapper found is a limited set of DICOM files which were unique. And on the right it says, okay, this is how I think the bits output should be. So it found here, for instance, this localizer, but it said, okay, I don't need, this is my prior knowledge that I put in. Localizer is not so interesting for bits, so leave that out of the bits data set. But then it found an anatomical scan. So this DICOM file, this one actually, so this is the DICOM header. So this DICOM file, it was automatically recognized as an anatomical scan. And it comes up with this naming scheme, subject 3, sessions, acquisition, something from the DICOM header. Well, so it says here subject session in the output. And that's taken from the input path. I don't like actually to have sessions. I have only one. So I'm just going to remove the session here. So now I have it a little bit simpler. But still, this acquisition field from the DICOM header, I don't like it too much. I'm going to edit this one. So I'm going to edit this mapping. So now I put in my user knowledge as a PhD student. I know, this was, for instance, coming from, from the UK Biobank. It is not from the UK Biobank, but I said, okay, this is a UK Biobank acquisition, UK Biobank. That's how I want my naming scheme to be. So, and then there's, here you can see the DICOM fields that I used to identify this DICOM file. And this is anatomy scan. So it's anatomy scan. And it has all these, it can also be T2 weighted if you like. But this was already properly recognized as a T1 because of I put the prior knowledge in there. I said this particular kind of scan is a T1. So I'm happy with it now. So now you see I get a nice bits output name. So you go on. You go through the list until you're happy with all the mapping. So all the unique DICOM files are mapped onto a proper bits name. Yeah, is that clear for everybody? If you have any questions now, you can interrupt me. Yeah?
Can you use several file names? For instance, you have a T1 MP-RAGE and an MP-RAGE T1 mapping?
Yeah, so the good thing about this approach, mapping approach, you can map many to one.
Okay.
Yeah, there's no problem. I will show you, because this is just, each line is a mapping. You can add as many lines as you like.
Okay. Can you use regular expressions too?
Expressions.
Regular expressions.
There are some things. So for instance, here what you can do, there's some smart things that I don't have a lot of time to show, but you can also, for instance, here, you can also say, okay, you can put like a star in there, stuff like that. Yeah, there are some smart things that are, yeah, advanced use it so you can have multiple, group them together into one mapping if you want. Okay. Yeah.
So I have three functional scans and they're all named the same in my scan protocol, so.
Yeah. But they are the same.
They're all the same. Is it going to recognize?
That's going to be run one, run two, run three.
So it does that for us.
Yeah, so here, for instance, you see this run and it goes with this bracket sort of thing, and that means that it automatically increased whenever the same one is encountered, so it goes to run two. Yeah? So, and the interesting one, so you can go through all of them, and then the field maps are already recognized here. So some of them actually is not recognized, so I put it in on purpose. So this was a functional scan that was not recognized, because it was not in my prior knowledge. So then you need to do it yourself. So now it recognizes extra data, because it's not bits. But I know it's bits, so in this case, it's this is a functional scan, so I say, okay, this is a function, I overrule it, so it's a functional scan, and it's indeed bold, so it could be anything, could also be something else, single band reference, so, but I say, this is a bold scan, and this was for my Stroop task or whatever, I don't know. Yeah, so the task should be, hang on, the task is above that, so this is, let's say, Stroop task. And the acquisition is from from the Rothbard, from the UMCN or so, whatever. Yeah, so you have something like this, and I don't like this information. I only have single echo. So now I get a very simple name. So you can make the names as you like it. So that's the idea. You can use optional bits fields if you want them. If you don't want them, you leave it empty. It's out of the name. Yeah? No, you do it once, so the bits mapper, if you have multiple participants with the same acquisition protocol, the bits mapper says it's the same mapping, yeah. It's just a different subject, but the mapping is the same. So it's a really short list of all the unique things, and this is actually very useful, because very often I had people here in the center, and then they had like 500 subjects, and then they ran the bits mapper, they have a very short list. But then after subject 243, suddenly a new mapping comes up because somebody changed something at the scanner. And they don't know. There was a software upgrade that slightly changed something and it comes up here. So you actually, it's very sensitive depending on the DICOM field that you put in detecting the consistency of your acquisition. If there's anything not consistent, it will come up as a new entry. Yeah, so you go through that, and actually the field map is always very hard. I have to move on a little bit, I think. How much time do I have? I have a little bit more time, yeah? Okay, that's good. So what I want to point you out to field maps, they are always difficult. The more problematic DICOM entry. So here in the field map, there's especially this intended for. So what is and that's where the bits is a data structure, but with field maps, you also that's where you put in like cross semantic links, like cross links. This map, bitmap, is associated with other files, like functional files, diffusion imaging files. Yeah. So, and here you can actually do a search function. So I can say, okay, this one is, for instance, intended for task data. Yeah. So now it will search for files which have in the bits name the tag task, and then it will, but I can also say, okay, it's for the Stroop task only, so then I have to actually, in this case, use these special brackets, but I say, okay, it's going to be for the Stroop task, so this is your bit like regular expressions that you, wanted to use. Yeah, so you can then say, okay, now it's going to be Stroop task, and I have to do that. So now I'm leaving certain fields out. Certain field maps that don't have an intended for, just to show you that it gives a warning for that, because field maps usually should come with the intended for. Okay, now I can go through all mappings, which I think is a bit boring. So what I will now do, I will say, okay, save this bits map. And so now it's saving it here, the bits map file. You can have a look at it if you want. And I'm replacing it. So now, in principle, we are done. So we have scanned the raw folder, identified the unique scans that we have, we with the GUI, we inserted the user knowledge that I know which one is which, and I sort of manipulated the file names how I like them to be. And now this is you can execute then this mapping, converting the data according to this mapping for all subjects by just running the BitsCoiner, so which is step two, which I will now do. So you can see here, so this is the log. The log file is also in a file. You can also look it up later to debug or to find any warnings. But in the end, you always get like a summary of all the warnings. So it says here, I did something expert uses because you only do that when you know what you're doing. This is not wrong. And it says here, it found certain actually field maps without an intended for field. So they're not going to be used by any package that reads them. So it just warns you for this. It's not wrong, but you just get a warning. And the log files, you can find them back. Yeah. So everything, all the provenance is logged. So every step that you do is then logged. So you can always find back how you can reproduce your data in this way very well, because you see all the steps that are done. And the same goes for the BitsCoiner. So now I'm going to do the conversion. I say the data is in raw, and it had to go to the Bits directory. And you just run it. And then this is it. So now it starts converting. Same thing, you get all these, there's a warning there, but it'll come back in the end. There's a summary report, and it's adding the task names. You see there's the warning again. So here are all the warnings that were found when converting, and they are about field maps. So let's see what we have. So we now have, instead of a raw folder, we also have the bits output folder, and there you see the metadata files, so the participants that were there. There were two participants, okay, that found it in the DICOM header, how heavy they were, and they were male or females. There's some skeleton files there. But there's also the code that was used. Well, in this case, that's where the log files are. And, of course, the bits data itself. So now we have, in extra data, we have, because I didn't specify them, some of them are in extra data, but we have field maps, and we have functional data. And here in subject 59, can everybody see this, by the way? Yeah. And we also have here the diffusion weighted imaging data, etc., with the file names as you saw them in the editor that I had. Yeah.
In the last comment you ran, you didn't add an additional parameter to explain where is the mapper.
Because it was in the default location.
Location.
You can also store it in different locations. You can. That's an optional argument. So if you want. If you look at the BitsCoiner, so if you want to help with the full options, you can of course do that. So there's like, for instance, here the bits map minus B. You can say you use your own bits map.
Okay.
Yeah. If a non-default one. So there's more to it than I just can tell you in this short demo.
So the default one, there's one default account when you download BitsCoin.
Yeah.
Okay.
But that's the template. And then when you add your user knowledge, so when you change it and you can replace it, or you can also save it in a different name. But then you have to use minus B here to load it.
Yeah.
Yeah?
Okay.
Is it output inheritance? I mean, like that common metadata is in a higher level? Or is it at the lowest level next to the files?
You mean the
acquisition? If you have a JSON with acquisition data, metadata, and you have common fields, is it in the utmost level or just...
Oh, that's what you mean. So it uses the JSON files from the DICOMs. They come from DCM to NIC, so they are not inherited.
Okay.
Yeah. They are at the lowest level, let's say. They're not... they don't do
the lowest level. Then.
Yeah.
Okay.
Which tool are you using for the DICOM to NIC?
DCM to NICs.
Because there are many around.
Yeah.
We typically like the DCM stack because it allows to completely inject the DICOM header into the Nifty. Would it be possible to change that?
Sure. So if you actually, I can show you, so I will now open the bits editor. But that needs a little bit of work. But in principle, I have to now say, of course, where the bits folder is. So now I open up this editor, so there's also options. So for instance here, you can see how I use DCM to NICs. So this is the option I didn't show you, but there's And then you can even test it if you want. You can say test, okay, now the test was successful. So you can also plug in a different converter if you want. But I'm afraid that because DCM2NICs comes with a lot of quirks, let's say. So if you have multi-coil data, it adds a suffix. And I tend to put a lot of if statements around DCM2NICs. Yeah, so that may not work out of the box, but you can definitely do that. Yeah, and there's also plugins.
If you're writing your repository once and then you create a set of metadata files and you manually adjust some metadata afterwards, is this overwritten if somebody runs this again? Or?
No. Which files do you mean, for instance, like participants.tsv or something like that?
In principle, I mean non-obligatory
BIDS. No, it's not. I don't overwrite.
Okay.
So if participants are appended. And I don't overwrite, so the scans.tsv also is just appended. If I find, so I don't throw away anything.
Does it support any Unicode character to create files?
Yeah, so I have to think about it a little bit. So in principle, it does. So everything that you can store in a YAML file.
Yeah.
Yeah. And the GUI, I think somewhere, so it's Python, so it's PyQt, so I think I have to specify it there. I can check it, what I support at the moment, but yes. There should be no problem.
I know some people want to have the patient name, for instance, in the file name. Is that possible?
So what you do, so that's a bit more advanced, use it. So if you look here, so the subject is now taken from the source file path, it says there. It means that in the raw folder, my source folder, I copy the name of the folder. Mm-hmm. But you can also put here a DICOM file. So I can also, for instance, say, okay, now what I want is patient's name, something like that. Let's see what happens. So patients. It's called patient names in DICOM. I can actually open it to see how it is. So there's instance, for instance, here. So what's it called again? Patient's name. Yeah, so this one now, this then should show up. Yeah, so let me just do that. Patient's name. So now I think, did it do that? It didn't, patient name, I think it is then in DICOM. How do I do it? Does that help? No, it doesn't help, right? Well, but you can read DICOM, put DICOM.
Without the S?
Without the S, I think, patient name. That was, now my screen is gone. Yeah, it's black. Where am I doing?
The first.
Yeah, I know. You see? Yeah?
Cool.
So it reads the DICOM header. Yeah, I can't demonstrate all the features, but you can also take it from DICOM header and put it in the bits name. Yeah. So this is what you wanted, right? Okay. Yeah, more questions in the back, maybe?
I don't know what tool you're using to get your data from the scanner. Many labs use AXNet.
No, we don't. So we have an automatic data flow. So in principle, we have our scanners embedded in a DICOM worklist broker. And then we have a PUC server. And from the PUC server, we have a custom script streaming it to our file server.
But that would be actually cool to...
I think you can integrate it with AXNet. It should be possible. We don't have XNAT server, that I don't work with it, but yeah, sure, you're welcome to make the connection, because it's just the input folder. Yeah. Pim.
My question was actually related, does it then automatically run the bits conversion from the scanner? Or
No, from the raw folder, so it's file structure from the raw folder.
Researchers always have to do it themselves, or do you do it for every scan sample?
The researchers do it themselves. Yeah, I also have some additional tools to, if you have a different organization of your raw data, to already make it, that's already a bit bits-like because it's a subject session. and it has DICOM series as separate folders. But if you have them as a DICOM dir, you can also just give the DICOM dir, and then it will also work.
Yeah, my goal is actually more like if you want to do automatic QC.
Yeah.
Everything that happens on the scanner, let's say. All the fMRI studies.
Yeah, then you need to have a very good bits map, so with all your prior knowledge in there. You can run this from in a cron job. All the data will get converted, and then you run MRI QC, for instance, yeah, on it, in the same cron job.
So the tool that Marcel has outlined, that's a tool that's developed for our research setting, but I think it's a very general purpose tool. So I think there's a lot of different use cases in which this tool could also be used. It's not the use cases that we're necessarily exploring here within the center, because we have a specific style of work which puts the PhD student in charge of data acquisition. We also often have to combine the data from the MR scanner with other data which also goes into the bit structure, such as the presentation log files, which also gets added to this, physiology which also gets added to this. So doing all the cognitive experiments, that is something that the researcher has oversight over, and that's not something that we can automatize only from the perspective of the MR scanner, because there's multiple computers involved. But it could be done if you know the data that you have.
So what I demoed was the GUI, which is mainly built to make it easy for PhD students to insert their knowledge that they have in the BITS dataset. But if you have a standard acquisition that's always the same, you don't need the GUI at all. You can just run, you make a good BITS map yourself as an institute or as a user, and then you just run the BITS corner only. So that contains the mapping. Yeah.
I think the last question.
Sorry.
It's very good. Is it already working also for PARREC files?
For PARREC files? No, not yet, because I don't have a PARREC converter myself. I don't have PARREC data, but it should be easy to do implement. Very easy, because the PAR header is also very simple.
So there's another tool called Bitsify, developed by Lucas Snook.
Yeah.
Who was also here, that does PARREC conversion, but it's also, it still needs a bit of development, but I'm using it. We could talk about it if you want.
But I think if I just parse the PAR file, it goes into this. You don't see it now, but it goes into this GUI directly. It's just the same with the same bits map. You can do PARREC. So it's really ignorant about DICOM, the GUI. It's just a mapping, and if it's from PARREC to bits or from DICOM to bits, doesn't matter. So I can easily build it, I think. Maybe a good hackathon project for next year. Yeah?
Well,
next year hackathon, I will launch this one. PARREC, maybe I've done it before and already. A plug. But if not, otherwise.
Thank you very much for your time.